So I will try to be on time. And so you already have the, oops, you already have the conclusion if you want. Up. Come on. Okay. So here you already have the conclusion. I mean, if you really want to go to leave for your first drink. So it's a pleasure to present this nice discovery of the detection of a relativistic jet from a black hole candidate in a globular cluster. So the idea of for a long time, I mean, if you look at globular cluster, I mean, you always find overabundances of X-ray binaries. And usually, I mean, they form differently from the standard X-ray binaries you have in the galactic plane. And usually, they are connected with a lot of stellar encounter. And for a long time, the idea was that the black hole, you should not have a lot of black hole in globular cluster because they should quickly escape. As of to date, there is no confirmed, dynamically confirmed black hole in globular cluster, but there has been this recent year, for example, by Geisser et al., some confirmed detached black hole, meaning black hole with no accretion in binary system, because usually they are in large orbit. But there has been some candidate based, for example, on radio observation in cluster by, for example, like people like Tom or James, and this is black hole X-ray binaries in quiescence. And so there is some topics also, some important question regarding the existence of intermediate mass black hole in globular cluster. And there have been even some people trying to link the collision of black hole in globular cluster. So one of the question is, do the globular cluster are able to retain their black hole? And one interesting target that has been active in December 2020, okay, it's this MAXI1848 plus minus 15. So this was discovered in December 2020. For people interested in the galactic plane, this is not a good time to have an active binaries. Is because you are close to the solar exclusion zone, so it means that no other X-ray satellite can point to this source. New star has been able to do some observation, and you can get some spectrum from new star, so you have something that is typical for black hole X-ray binaries with hard state, soft state, and also they've been able to measure reflection feature and also some information of the spin of the source, which is a high spin sources. So all of these favor a black hole candidate. But you can see from the MAXI activity, I mean, the outburst was very short, which is not typical for this kind of X-ray binaries. Of course, a new star that has not been able to localize it precisely, but when the source became visible by X-ray satellite, SWIFT, Chandra, observe and have been able to localize it in the globular in the cluster GLIMPSE01. And it's not coincident with any of the other sources. So as I mentioned, this is a short duration outburst. I mean, as you can see here, you have less than 100 days, which is quite short. And there is a radio counterpart detected by Meerkat, which is connected with a radio jet. So GLIMPSE01, it's a poorly understood globular cluster. It was discovered by Spitzer in the early 2000s. So you have an image here of this globular cluster. In optical, you don't see anything. It's because it is heavily extinguished. We have an optical extension of 15 magnitude, which is quite large. But if you go to infrared or even with Spitzer, you see the concentration of star that you can find here. This is an image from Chandra. From the archival published by Poulet et al. So you have a lot of like 15 X-ray sources, which is quite a large population of X-ray sources. And there is some idea that this is a globular cluster passing through the galactic plane. But this is not a cluster that is as typical as what you can find in the outskirts of the galaxy. And there, so it's a little bit more compact. So this cluster may be what we call a rare intermediate age cluster. So it's not a standard globular cluster. So what do we observe? So this is work done initially by for example, Alex Tentarenko, Lilia Trimou, and Aras Baramian, people associated with the Thundercat collaboration in the for Meerkat. So with first observation with VLA, detected two lobes. So you have two arc second scale here, and we have faint sources located at the core. And then when we continue observation with Meerkat, on time scale of several months, 2 years. So we observe, the expansion of this lobe up to large distances. So this is detected, has been for 2 years. It's still active right now in radio. And so as you can see, today, there has been a paper by Aras Baramian. It is published today. And so this is the modeling of the proper motion of the, you can see, for example, the separation of the two jets. We have been able to do the modeling, detail modeling with a deceleration jet model, constant deceleration. And you can get some information on the, for example, proper motion here, which is quite typical of what you find in other galactic black hole candidates. So what can we get? We can get some information of the distance of the sources, assuming that the jet is, you take a velocity of beta equal one, then you take your maximum distance of, you obtain a maximum distance of 4.2 kiloparsec, which is consistent with the distance of the cluster. And if you assume it is the distance of the cluster, which is 3.3 up, can be a little bit higher depending of the publication you take, you can get the information of the jet angle and the intrinsic velocity of the jet, which is of the order of 0.79 c, which is not the fastest one. It's, in fact, it's a little bit slower than what you found in other sources. But one of the first conclusions, this is the first relativistic jet detected from an X-ray binary in a globular cluster. And this is interesting because the density of the cluster are different of what you can find in the galactic plane. So this is a way to probe the jet ISM interaction in an exotic environment. So we have an extended campaign with Sandra and VLA. And also we use the archival Sandra data to look for X-ray activity. So this is a typical field of view of Chandra, one of Chandra taking it from the archive. So you see a lot of plenty sources, plus of course some new sources. So the X1, that was a source that's known before, and all of that, that's different sources not known. So here you have the angular separation versus time, and this is intensity. This is important to notice that you have different evolution. And this is 1, 2, 3, 4, this is the date of the Chandra observation I'm going to talk. And I will specifically focus on observation number 3, which is close to the peak of the radio light curve of the jet that we detected in the south. I will mostly discuss of the jet in the south, which is the approaching jet. Okay. So this is one example of the image. So we do, I do sub-pixel analysis, and this allow me to find, for example, this is location, this source is connected to the north one. And here this is, so this is X6 is the background sources, but here you have a new sources here in X-ray, which correspond to, in fact, the radio lobes. So we have X-ray counterpart to the radio jet, and these sources are moving. And in fact, I will show you later that they even resolve in radio and in X-ray. So we have discovery of moving X-ray sources with both radio jets. Okay, this is an example. I mean, a zoom, for example, this is one of the background sources, and this is the jet detected. Okay. So I will go fast on this one, but just to illustrate, for example, this is the profile along the jet axis for observation number 2. This is the north jet, for example. This is the south jet. This is observation number 3. You can see, you don't maybe see that very well, but this is the size of the PSF. You clearly see that the source are resolved in terms of X-ray emission. And you can see we can decompose the jet in X-ray with a head or hotspot, if you prefer, and a three arc second extended tail. And something that I have no time to discuss, but if we overplot the radio profile with the X-ray profile, we see that we have an evolution with, for example, in the beginning, the radio are inside, and at the end, we have the radio are on the external part and the X-ray closer inside. So we have a lot of information that I don't have time to discuss here. Okay, then fine. So for example, this is a spectral energy distribution for the jet, the south jet in observation number three. So this is depending if you include Mercat or not. The SOD is consistent with a power law, and that will be consistent with synchrotron emission with an index of minus 0.77 roughly. And I'll remind you that this observation number three corresponds to this one where we are the peak of the radio emission. So if you assume equipartition, because the fact that we've resolved the source, and in fact, I may have time here. This is here, for example, you can compare the radio image that is also resolved on the X-ray map. And so you can see there is a pretty good correspondence for this one. And so if I have the volume, both along the jet and perpendicular to the jet. So I can get, this is something that is difficult to measure usually. So I can get some information on the minimum internal energy, which is in fact quite large when we compare to the energy injected. That's something that we found when we use ISM as a calorimeter to measure the energy in the jet. We usually found a number that is quite large. Magnetic field is standard to what we obtain. In fact, if we compare the fact that we have a synchrotron up to X-ray means that we have electrons with an energy of several tenths of TeV. So, of course, if I show the observation number three, it's because this is the simplest one. And if you look at this one. If you look at the radio spectra, I mean, or the other observation, it's not. It's a little bit more complicated. They are very very steep. And if I go to the, for example, SD, so this is observation number three. So you see the Mercat point here on the VLA. But you see that all the other radio observations, they are not consistent with a single power law. So, and in fact, the only one that is consistent with a pure synchrotron is the one that is associated with a peak in the radioemitting, which in fact, which is expected, this is when you expect the maximum efficiency of the particle acceleration. And for the other one, I mean, X-ray SSC or inverse Compton is also unrealistic because this will require a lot of energy in the particle. Thermal X-ray is also unlikely. So we also likely need to have two populations of electrons, one probably associated with a reverse shock and one with a forward shock. I can compare with other examples. We had several examples of X-ray detection of jet from this kind of sources, but for most of the time, they were always consistent with a pure synchrotron. And I think for this one, because the variability has been much more larger, we have been able to sample different behavior. Something also I mentioned, we have a detection in observation number four, which was 120 kiloseconds. We have the detection of the core. So we detected the quiescence of this Maxi 1848 sources. We have a very good upper limit in radio. And if we use the standard radio X-ray correlation, we fit in this corner where we have the other black hole. And this, if we comp the mass, we assume the fundamental plane. We have a upper limit on the mass of the black hole of 100 solar masses. And if you look at the quiescent luminosity, this is consistent with the luminosity you will expect for a black hole with a short orbital period, which is what we expect in this kind of environment. So it's not a proof that it is a black hole, because but we have no intermediate mass black hole, but we need to have the a way to measure the mass function, but that will be complicated because the source is very absorbed. So this is the first detection from a relativistic jet from an X-ray binary outburst in a globular cluster. We have indication for black hole primary, but this is not a proof because we don't have the mass function yet. Interaction of a relativistic jet with the environment. So we have a lot of complex variability, but I think this is very standard for the gamma ray burst. But we need to be able to collect as much as data from for the to continue SED. And I think in terms of prospect for SKR and JVLS, so the important is that we have large field of view, resolution, frequency, coverage, flexibility for TO, that will be important. Someone mentioned subarrays. Or someone, if someone would like to buy the old VLA installed is somewhere, but we need someone to also have the monitoring. But detected transient is something, but we need to be able to follow them afterward for a long time. That is important. And of course, the synergy with the high energy instrument. But this is also very, very important. Thank you.
All right, do we have some questions for Stefan?
Hi, thank you. Sorry if my question is naive, but if I want to understand, especially in the globular clusters, which has a higher binary fraction, to know whether the source itself is a genuine black hole or is it still the X-ray binary, what information do we really need to have to actually disentangle between these two?
If you want to do that, it will be to measure the mass function. You need to detect the optic, the counterpart, the companion star, and to do mass function and get the orbital parameter. But that will be very difficult because this is very absorbed. I know there is an infrared, possibly an infrared counterpart, but so you need to measure the spectral line from the companion star and do the typical Doppler shift and then you will get the mass function. That's the only way to be sure that you have a black hole. Because for the moment, this is, you have indication from the X-ray spectra. The spin is quite fast, and it's difficult to have it for a neutron star system. You have reflection feature, so you have state transition, but neutron star do state transition too. And you have a behavior, jet is not a proof that it is a black hole, because you have neutron star with relativistic jet, so the real clue will be to get the mass function of the that's the only way.
Right,
but
you.
It will be difficult.
All right. Do we have some other questions for Stefan? Oh yeah.
Thanks. Maybe you said this during the talk, and I may have missed it, but it interested me that the globular cluster you found this in was not a globular cluster that I knew. And there was a comment there about maybe it was at a slightly different evolutionary stage in that. Is that a suggestion here that this is occurring in that type of a globular cluster and that we're looking in the wrong place?
This cluster, when it was, I'm not a specialist in cluster, probably you are more than me, I'm sure. And there is several publications discussing the status of this cluster. And for one of them, it's supposed to be, could be an intermediate age of the order of two billion years maximum, because there is different population of stars in this cluster. So it's not a standard one, it's more compact. The size for this one is, the half-life radius is 30 arcseconds.
So I guess my question then is that maybe made it easier for this to have occurred? Because at the beginning you talked about the fact that
No, it's just random because it's a cluster in a gaseous plane. So in the beginning it was supposed to be coincidence, but something I did not mention is the X-ray sources is exactly at the location of the core of the cluster. So doesn't prove it associated, but this is the same distance also.
Okay, do we have some other questions for Stefan? Okay, I get a couple.
Yes, there is
one. Oh, somebody over there, okay. Yeah. I'll talk to you later then. Yeah, Dylan.
Are there limits on the mass or luminosity of the companion star?
I think I have no idea. I mean, it's very probably very faint. Yeah, companion stars, there is an infrared counterpart, but it doesn't mean that the infrared emission you have is from the companion star. It can still be from the accretion because it was during the outburst. So you will need to do now that the core is off to do this optical search for the counterpart. Okay. But I think with an extension of 15 magnitude in optical, I think it's hopeless, almost.
Okay, I think we have time for one more quick question if somebody has one. Okay, if not, let's thank Stefan again.